number one multicultural channel. This is Tag TV.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with Rice in a dialogue in New Delhi, which was attended by global leaders who shared their views on important challenges facing the world. They discussed issues including globalization, 2030 agenda and role of technology in modern world, climate change and counter-terrorism. A report.
Raisina Dialogue, a three-day conclave, brought together 700 international participants, of which 40% of the women speakers, emphasizing India's commitment to gender equality. The world leaders hailed Prime Minister Narendra Modi's leadership and vision with respect to a range of global issues. Speaking at the inaugural session of the Raisina Dialogue 2020, former Danish Prime Minister Anders Fogh Rasmussen said that he would like to see India as a strong component of the global alliance of democracies and appreciate Prime Minister Modi's leadership in that respect. Former Canadian Prime Minister Stephen Harper, whose address centered around challenges faced by liberal democracies in coping with political protests in their own countries, hailed Modi, under whose leadership India has become self-defined. Former Afghan President Hamid Karzai laid stress on Afghan peace initiatives and asked the United States to play its role in bringing peace in his country.
The overwhelming majority of the Afghan people would agree to the U.S. presence in Afghanistan, provided Afghanistan becomes peaceful and the Afghan people are given the opportunity to live in a dignified way in their own country, meaning that there is no interference in our affairs, that they don't set the election results for us, that they don't do things that would hurt our sovereignty or sentiments. With that condition, the pillar of which is, of course, peace, then the U.S. may be given the right to stay. But that decision has to be made by the Afghan people through the proper institutions that represent the Afghan people.
Important challenges facing the world related to globalization, 2030 agenda, role of technology in modern world and climate change were part of the discussion. Former Bhutan Prime Minister Sherring Tobgay said he was a believer in multilateralism, but the UN Security Council had failed on climate change.
To have just one country out of 195 countries to be carbon neutral is unacceptable. And yes, the developed world must step forward. We need champions. When you talk of climate change, it is this is a tragedy of commons in a truly global scale. And to solve such a problem, you need global champions. And champions must come from all countries, India included.
India's Chief of Defence Staff General Bipin Rawat demanded the exclusion and isolation of countries that sponsor terrorism from global coalitions put together to fight the menace. He laid emphasis that there has to be international action against Pakistan and some hard messaging such as blacklisting by the Paris-based Financial Action Task Force.
You have to have an international messaging that has to go to them, hard action being taken. And I feel one of the measures that has been adopted is blacklisting by the FATF is one good measure. Diplomatic isolation, you have to do this. You have to bring about acceptability in the nation that yes, they are sponsors of terrorism. Denial of terrorism, to say that they are not denying it, they are themselves victim of terrorism, cannot continue for on and on.
In a short space of 5 years, the Raisina dialogue has acquired an enviable global profile, uniting the best strategic thinkers of the world. The synergies and collaborations in the Raisina dialogue represent India's deliberative ethos as well as the international credibility and convening power.
Well, to speak more on this, we are now joined by a geopolitical expert. What, according to you, sir, are the major takeaways of the Raisina Dialogue 2020? And do you think it has been able to appropriately discuss the major challenges being faced by the world today?
You know, it was one of the most important forums emerging among the developing countries. It not only, you know, dealt with the Indian issues related to India's foreign policy, but also provides a platform to many other developing and developed nations as well, you know, because so many countries are participating, and almost all the major issues confronting with the developing world was taken up, was thoroughly discussed and debated during the conference. It's a very important occasion, you know. Large number of foreign ministers and other higher officials from different countries participated in this conference. Indian foreign minister, you know, Mr. Jaishankar has explained the parameters of our India's foreign policy. So all the issues related with foreign policy was discussed. And since the Iranian foreign minister was there, concerns of the Persian Gulf was also raised, in the sense, you know, that India wants peace, stability of the region, which is too close and too important for us.
Do you think India has become a major player in the international arena, considering the fact that 100 countries are participating in the conference being led and organized by New Delhi?
You know, India is a major power. And secondly, you know, India is one country which also championed the cause of developing nations. So India, especially the Prime Minister, you know, takes a lot of, care, you know, when it comes to the issues related to developing nations. You know, we have been always, you know, whether it is G20 or UN forums or any other regional or international organizations, you know, Indian representatives not only talk about our concerns or our problems, you know, but also the problems related to the developing nation. So we have a role at the globe. Then India is also providing security to the sea lanes, you know, spreading right from Gulf of Hormuz up to the Strait of Malacca and beyond now, you know, the Indo-Gulf also.
Moving on to Gilgit-Baltistan, an occupied territory of Jammu and Kashmir by Pakistan, where the students of Karakoram International University have been demonstrating against the immoral fee hike. It's been over 3 months now, but the students' agitation failed to get the attention of concerned authorities. We have a report.
It's been over 3 months since the students of Karakoram International University in Gilgit-Baltistan are demonstrating against the immoral fee hike, but that seemed to have no impact on the authorities. Hundreds of students recently boycotted classes and blocked China-Pakistan Economic Corridor route on the Karakoram Highway. The troubles have compounded for students, with administration not allowing them to take their university exams. The university position has only worsened the three-month-long impasse where no side is ready to budge. Strict action, however, have not been able to dampen students' morale as they are only widening their movement. Anti-administration rallies and marches are being organized in almost all corners of Gilgit-Baltistan. Students have termed it discriminatory and suppressive as students of Karakoram International University have been subjected to a fee hike.
सारी इससे उससे इदारों से ये मतलब वो कर रही हैं दरख्वास्त कर रही हूं कि हमारी ये बात सुने और हमें पढ़ने दें और हमें आगे बढ़ना हमने कौम को आगे बढ़ाना है हम ही कौम के मेमार हैं तो हम मेरी गुजारिश है आप लोगों से कि मतलब हमारी फीस का ये इशू खत्म करें और हमें पढ़ाई में डिस्टर्ब ना करें और हमारे पेपर्स लिए जाएं एक तो इतनी ज्यादा सर्दी है सर्दी के मारे हम यूनिवर्सिटी में मतलब बड़ी मुश्किल से रह रहे हैं फिर भी हमें इस तरह बीच में डिस्टर्बेंस क्रिएट कर रहे हैं
As per the scheme, the students of Masters and MPhil were not supposed to pay any tuition fee for their courses, but the administration changed the rule overnight and asked them to pay a hefty fee as soon as they entered their second semester. Students have two fundamental demands: rollback of the increment in the fee and reinstatement of fee reimbursement scheme.
मैं इमरान खान साहब से कहती हूँ क्योंकि फाटा में पीटीआई की हुकूमत है तो वहाँ ये बहाल किया गया इधर पीटीआई की हुकूमत नहीं है तो यहाँ नहीं किया ये तब्दीली है क्या क्या इसको हम तब्दीली समझते हैं ये बिल्कुल हमारे साथ बहुत बहुत बुरा सलूक हो रहा है तो हम काइंडली उनसे कह रहे हैं कि हमें वो माफ़ी ये माफ़ी होनी चाहिए फीस माफ़ी और ये हम स्ट्राइक मार्च तक करेंगे टिल मार्च तक अगर हमें ना मिला तो हम अब तक नहीं दे रहे पेपर से हम निकलें हमारा कैरियर का वो हो रहा है पूरी यूथ गिलगित-बल्तिस्तान की यूथ सफ़र कर रही है उनको एहसास होना चाहिए इमरान खान साहब को कि वो इसके लिए हमें ग्रांट दे दें और हमारी ये स्कीम बहाल करें
ये धोखाबाजी
ना मंजूर
ये धोखाबाजी
ना मंजूर
ये झूठे वादे
ना मंजूर
बैक इन 2011 इन ऑर्डर टू इंप्रूव द पुअर स्टेट ऑफ एजुकेशन द पाकिस्तान पीपल पार्टी हैड टेकन द डिसीजन ऑफ मेकिंग द हायर एजुकेशन फ्री फॉर ऑल स्टूडेंट्स इन ऑक्यूपाइड गिलगित-बल्तिस्तान एंड पाकिस्तान फेडरली एडमिनिस्टर्ड ट्राइबल एरियाज However, all these academic ambitions of students were trampled upon by Imran Khan-led administration in a systematic approach to deprive the students of Gilgit-Baltistan. This is not an isolated incident when Islamabad has systematically attacked the youth and in particular the students of Gilgit-Baltistan. It has misused several laws including the Anti-Terrorism Act to infuse a sense of fear in youth of the region.
Let's move on to Bangladesh, where the second largest annual Muslim congregation called Biswa Ijtima held in Tongo on outskirts of capital Dhaka. Braving cold and dense fog, devotees from far and wide of the country gathered at the Ijtima ground.
Thousands of devotees gathered on the banks of Turak River in Tongi to take part in Biswa Ijtima, the second largest congregation of Muslim community in the world. The Ijtima is a prayer meeting during which attending devotees perform daily prayers while listening to scholars reciting and explaining verses from the Quran. It culminates in the Akhiri Munajat or the concluding supplication, final prayer, Maulana Zubair Ahmed, in which millions of devotees raise their hands in front of Allah and pray for world peace. The Ijtima is considered a demonstration of Muslim unity, solidarity, mutual love and respect, and an opportunity to reiterate their commitment to Islamic values.
বড় ধরনের ইজতেমা হজের পরে এটা বড় স্থান এখানে সবাই আসে আমরা মুসলমানরা সব একত্রিত হই এখানে আমরা হজের পরে যে বড় দোয়া হবে এটা এই দোয়া দ্বারা আমাদের দেশের এবং আমাদের সবার উপকার হবে
Bishwa Ijtema is being held at the same site since 1966 and is organized by World Tabligh Council, which preaches teachings of Islam and Prophet Muhammad. Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina, accompanied by her younger sister Sheikh Rehana, took part in the munajat from her official Gana Bhavan residence. The event was held in two phases, in which noted ulema mashayikhs in their sermons called for following the guidance of the Holy Quran and Sunnah. The sermons were translated in different languages of the world. Overcrowded trains and buses carried scores of worshippers to and from the prayer event. Bangladesh is home to 169 million people, the majority of whom are Muslims.
Now we take you to Nepal, a country known for its vibrant culture and festivities. Swasthani Brata Katha, a month-long ritual of fasting dedicated to Lord Shiva, is being organized in Bhaktapur city. Devotees observing the fast worship Lord Shiva and pray for the well-being of their family. Take a look.
Women donned in maroon-red outfits gathered on the banks of Salinadi River to take a dip and worship Lord Shiva. Braving the winter chill, the devotees followed the same rituals for the entire month to celebrate the festival of Sri Swasthani Brata Katha, in which devotees recite chapters from the book called Swasthani. After offering prayers, the women eat food devoid of salt and other spices, and that too only once a day.
Ek mahina bhari hami 4 baje uthchhau. अनि यहाँ 4 बजे शंख बजाउँदै आउनुहुन्छ सागनहरु अनि शंख बजाएपछि हामी सुत्नु हुँदैन अनि उहाँहरूले शंख बजाएपछि हामी आएर साली नदीमा आएर अनि माधव नारायण भगवानलाई माथि स्नान गराउनु हुन्छ हामी तलबाट स्नान गर्छौं अनि त्यहाँबाट आएर हामी यहाँ अग्नि ताप्छौं अलिअलि अनि अहिले पूजा सुरु हुन्छ यहाँ सबै भक्तजनहरु सिद्धि सकेपछि हामीलाई पूजा सुरु गराउनु हुन्छ गुरुहरुले अनि पूजा गर्न सकेर अनि माधव नारायण घुमाउन लानुहुन्छ माधव नारायण घुमाउन लागेपछि त्यहाँ जलचरा सहस्त्र धारा हुन्छ माधव नारायणको शिरमा त्यो सहस्त्र धारामा जल चराएपछि अनि हामीले कोठामा गएर खानेकुरा जे पकाएर खाँदा हुन्छ
During the ritual, devotees who take on fast for a month do not eat food cooked by others. They devour various types of food that are prepared to mark the end of the day. It is believed that everything in the food has to be 108 pieces, including flowers. The fasting food majorly includes eat rice, beaten rice, sugar, ghee, sugar candy, molasses, spinach from Patan, peas amongst those considered sacred. The sermon recited for a month mentions that Goddess Parvati prayed to Goddess Swasthani to become Lord Shiva's wife, because of which unmarried females also observe fast, praying to get a suitable groom. The married men pray for the well-being and progress for their spouses and children.
Swasthani ko mata ko mahatwa parivar sal ni baseko thiyo ani babu ko chha ke re hat bhacheko thiyo ani tyo ichha pura bho ani babu lai australia jana lai pr laos bhane thi ani layo ichha pura bho ani yahi bhara
Celebration of such festivals depicts how people have preserved their culture and traditions for ages.
India's diversity is best reflected in its fairs and festivals. Recently, the Harvest Festival was celebrated across the country with a show of brilliant colors and festivities. The festival marks the start of northward journey of the sun and the beginning of the end of winter and the coming of spring. It is a festival of togetherness and delicacies. It is celebrated as the onset of a new season of hope and harvest and is observed under different names across the country. Let's take a look.
Festivals in India are celebrated with great passion and joy. festival of Makar Sankranti, known throughout India, is celebrated in different parts of the country with different names, but the significance of welcoming the harvest season was common across all communities. In most parts of northern India, mostly in cities, lining the holy rivers such as Ganges, millions of Hindus brave the cold temperatures and begin the day by taking a dip in the holy waters while paying obeisance to the sun. It is a merriment time all across the region.
आज गुरु गोविंद सिंह जी ने 40 मुक्तों का बदावा फाड़ा था और मुक्तसर में बनाते हैं लेकिन अमृतसर आई हूँ मैं स्पेशल दिल्ली से मत्था टेकने स्नान किया मैंने कीर्तन सुना है बाबा जी का हुक्मनामा सुना है तो मुझे बहुत अच्छा लगता है
The people of Punjab celebrate Holi, which is one of the most zestful festivals of northern India. It is believed that the festival is celebrated on the day when days start becoming shorter and the nights start becoming longer. This festival is celebrated as the harvest festival, and on this day, people light bonfire, sing and dance in joy to pay respect to the Dulla Bhatti. People gather around the rising flames, circle around the bonfire, offer munchies like puffed rice and popcorn to the fire, and dance to popular folk songs. For Punjabis, this is more than just a festival, it is a celebration of life.
हम स्वच्छता को लेकर मैसेज देना चाहते हैं कि अपना आला दाला साफ रखें, प्लास्टिक का यूज ना करें, पॉलीथीन बंद करें।
In the western state of Gujarat, Makar Sankranti is celebrated as the festival of Uttarayan. The state is decorated with kais of all shapes and sizes. The festival is dedicated to the Hindu sun god Lord Surya. The festival marks the beginning of a 6 months auspicious period for the Hindus known as Uttarayan period.
पूरे दिन में बच्चों के साथ पूरा मतलब पतंग पतंग चगाते हैं और दोपहर को खाना खाते हैं और फैमिली के साथ एंजॉय करते हैं
In Assam, Bhogali Bihu, also known as Magh Bihu, is celebrated during this time every year and observed with gaiety and reverence. Magh Bihu marks the completion of harvesting and heralds the coming of spring. Locals are immersed in festive spirit. Fun and frolic accompanied with the purity and piousness form a distinctive feature of the festival. The Makar Sankranti celebrations reflect the amazing diversity of the rich cultural tradition of India. It is this variety that is a special hallmark of India. What is even more amazing is how India embraces so much diversity.
India has the most vibrant harvest festivals, which include interesting mythological legends and joyous celebrations. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
Number one multicultural channel. This is Tag TV.